So I was in a small shop. I was in a small, not even a shop, like a, almost like a four side of a chair, like that kind of a big table, and I put my saris and I was there for 15 days in Chennai. I just did one of my first project in textile that was happened in Chandigarh, and I was showing my work in Chennai. It was for 14 days, I think 10 days have gone, and I have few more things put it on my table, and I was waiting, okay, this much I have left. And I was very proud, you know, things sells, you know, people I think like simple things. And then Uma comes from Pondicherry, because that's a 4 or 5 hour journey, right? Do you remember that day? And she comes and says, whatever is left over is all for me. I was like, wow. I said, well, I will have no nothing take back with me. And that was a day. So thank you, Uma, for doing that, encouraging that. So I think what I really want to say, my work started not even thinking that I'm going to be a textile designer or a fashion designer. It's almost, in India, I don't know, there's a word called dwand. I don't know how many people understand Hindi here, and there's a vartalap or conversation. I think I walked through, going through that you know, what is, so it's an ongoing engagement with my own self. The dwand doesn't have a negative meaning, but it has always a many different ways of thinking. Nothing can be, I always question, let's say, sari or handloom or pure estate. So I'll give you an idea, like I always thought, what is this pure estate? And what is this idea of the people who wear khadi or wear indigo, and that's a very idea of very puristic textile. I always question, I don't agree fully that our grandparents or our great grandmas, we always say, oh, you know, she only loved handloom sari. I don't think so that was a reality. I think she didn't have any other option. So I always wanted to question that, you know, we all say, you know, 100 years ago we only did khadi and we love khadi and we don't even bother today. Actually, the reality is that there was no other way to make the yarn. So only you could only spun by hand, that while you wore khadi. So these things, also, you know, I always wanted to ask, what is wrong with the making money? I absolutely appreciate what Uma has done. I think she's the rarest of being 0.001% who dedicate fully her life to the society or the nation. But I don't see that everyone else doing it, or at least someone else working for her, maybe not thinking the way that she's thinking. I think she's doing it amazingly great. But you know, I always question, how will I get the great brains who are paid for a computer design, or maybe they're a great professor. I also want them to be paid, or I also want to see the textile as a great future. How do we create role model? How do we create new jobs? How do I, my younger brother, not to go to join a computer engineering class and ask them, you know, come here, you come and join me. I always thought, why don't we have a great examples of textiles company or handloom, so which has a great brand build up, and you see there's a future. I think we need to create a lot of role model in terms of businesses. And that's one of the way of doing it. And I always question that, you know, why, as I said yesterday, doing sustainability or doing ethical is not very special. I think every business has to be sustainable and ethical business. And if it is done in the right way, then why not? And I also question, you know, in my whole work, what is tradition? Is tradition a past? Is the tradition a past thing? Or tradition is today, or tradition a future? I've always been thinking, I think tradition is a very ongoing thing. I don't think so, tradition is a thing of past. So how do you contribute to on tradition and make a future out of it? More than that, the product sari, what I designed, they had a great stigma when I started. Sari means only supposed to be Bhanji or Mataji's. And it was never understood for 4 years when I started working. I was not also accepted as a fashion designer maybe. I was not written in any magazine or a fashion magazine. They didn't even take me seriously, or they didn't think as a fashion design. I always wanted to say, so I always thought that sari has nothing to do with modern and old tradition. It's going to be always a future. So we have touched upon many things on it. I'm just going to have few examples. So well, when I started working, I remember my manager, Vandana, so do you remember Kripal Mathur ma'am? So when I was in a class, NIFT in textile, she told me, who can wear lime green and this totei? Everyone understands totei green? She said, it's such a gawaru color, it's a very rural color. You know, these things used to very hurt me, because I came from a village and always used to question, what is the sophistication? And who decide what's the sophistication? Who decide what is bright or or not bright, and who decide? And I really remember Indira Gandhi wearing a lot of very sophisticated neutral colors. I always question, where is this reference coming from? My life condition different, my body color is different, who decide what color goods for me? I think so Raw Mango, first of all, we started with using the vibrant colors, and we known for our vibrant color. That doesn't mean that we only use the vibrant color, we also use I love always extremism, I think, so we did use very bright color or almost no color. So, as you can see so this photograph clicked by me, and I had no money then to pay to any you know, fashion photographer. So we also questioned the visual imagery, which I'm going to come down later, but this is my sister, and I asked her, can you please model for me? I said, I have no money, and I also do not like the way fashion photographers shoot our Indian textile, because it's a very borrowed aesthetic. I don't see the fashion, or I don't see the fashion with the pouch in the model. My model doesn't look like the same, and it always looks like she borrowed the clothes from someone. I don't think so, she owns it. So there's just such a disconnect between people who are wearing and people are modeling it. So these are the colors, by the way. So as you can see, this is the gulabi pink, and this is a tote green, and it has a small rose patterns on it. By the way, this whole inspiration for me came through Raja Ravi Ram Verma's paintings. And I thought of that, you remember, everyone must have seen those Lakshmi Bai or Rani or goddesses, and they are black and white, and you paint them over it, color, and you put some textile over it. So that was the whole idea of it. And also, you know, everything matters to me. Look at the way body language it is. Models never sit on the floor, you see. I always have a question, why can't you just cross your legs and sit? So this small things, okay, let me put it this way also. I go to any five-star hotels or any dining hall, I still don't know how to sit on a chair for the longest time. I get so tired, and I put my feet up in the flights or in the or the restaurant, so that would come from me. So I said, why don't you just sit down? So this one is this we recently shot in, it's called Radha, and we shot in Vrindavan. And we didn't even know where are we going to shoot. We just walking down the street, we found this beautiful temple, and it's temple owned by Sindhyas. No one has seen it, no one knows about it. We had to talk to a Panditji, and he just let us in. And that's what this girl also, actually, again, not a model, she's a textile designer, and she's somehow convinced. And we should put a lot of colors on her. It's about the Radha. The Radha, I think, is a mystery lover of Krishna, and that's kind of the imagery of her here. Okay, so I'm going to a little bit talk about what all kind of textile we deal with it and what we have done through it. So this is one of this is our main textile, I think, what we know and what Uma has bought that time, Chanderi. So Chanderi, when I went to Chanderi, what happened was that, so there are different segments of weaver. There are weaver who used to just plain weave, just make a plain fabric. There are people who used to make the pallu, and there are people who used to make all over pattern, and there are people who make border and the patterns on the border. So whatever they knew, whatever you know from last 2000 year old heritage or skills that they used to put on one sari, they had no clue how to separate the color or a motif, and how do you make a collection out of it. So that was one of, it's only editing, by the way. I don't think so I've done much but the edited. So the same motif I use is one of the Bodh Gaya tree motif, but I've done it in a white and silver. So it had a lot of work, but actually I simplified it. So this is a Chanderi where we have, traditionally we never use silver jari or a copper jari or a white and silver. So we've come with a lot of different color of jaris and patterns. And this was the first intervention in Chanderi in terms of visual vocabulary. This is mushroom. So what you see here, the mushroom fabric, the mushroom was just a fabric and that comes from central part of Asia. And as I said, it came through to a trade route through Gujarat. And mushroom was woven in Gujarat, Deccan and Varanasi. And right now what you only see mushroom in Gujarat. And there is a myth that mushroom is only from Gujarat, which is not true. So mushroom was woven three different parts of India from last 50 years is only woven in Gujarat. So as it came just as a fabric and it came through a trade route and actually is worn by a Muslim man. So it was a thick fabric. As it came from Central Asia, there was a cold weather. So it was a thick fabric but never worn as a sari. So people in Gujarat only buying maybe for the ghagra or the blouse, but this was it. So either I accept it the way it is and I do not question the purity of the craft, or I do not think of that, you know, how do I take it further, or this is what mushroom known to me. I question, is mushroom a technique, or mushroom a color, or mushroom is a pattern? It's kind of a sari. What do you sari means to you? A sari is a 5.5 meter of the fabric, or sari the way it is styled, or sari the way it is woven, or sari is the way what you talk about the moti, or sari is all of it become a sari for you. So what is that one thing, and how do you fracture it? How do you divide it? So to me, mushroom was a technique, and I also wanted to work with it, and I also wanted to have lot many weavers, because no one was weaving that time in Varanasi. So we came up with a fabric which has a cotton body, and mushroom is only woven in the fabric. Because the thick, so see, the sari also has a great science, by the way. I don't know how many people know, and we think, oh, sari doesn't have any design other than pattern and color. But not true. So, you know, the sari has a border. The border takes care of a wear and tear. It has a salvage. Salvage has a purpose to solve in textile. It takes and wear and tear, and it also gives us some weight. When you drape a sari, the basic fabric is much lighter than the border, so it gives you the weight. And also, all the decoration is only in the pallu. And what pallu does to you when you drape a sari like that, it holds a certain weight. So sari is a great science in engineering. So we wanted to design a mushroom sari, which is the body is made out of cotton and border is mushroom. This is one of the photos, but I've been questioned that, you know, this is not really a mushroom then, but you know, it's so well received now, and it's woven in Varanasi. It's around 100 weaver who's weaving mushroom right now, and we're also trying to, there are mushroom with three kinds. One was small motif, second was all, there was a minimal stripe, as you can see, and third was ikats. So there's no more ikats woven from last 50 to 60 years in India. And ikats are only woven in Deccan India, which is Andhra Pradesh, and we're trying to work on that. I do not use word called revival and survival, because I've always been saying these are the wrong word. If you revive something and it keeps dying again and again, you just cannot pump in. You need to work on design. I think what need to sell is design, craft, and culture and as availability, rather than revival and survival, emotional. I don't know how many people are familiar with our Indian wedding scene. So whenever the bride actually is supposed to wear at least 30 to 50 kgs of langas and the weight, if it's not fully embroidered or not fully patterned and a lot of colors. So that was something, you know, not, I don't know how do I say that, but the perceived intelligent or intellect designer would not touch it, because they would only talk about indigo and khadi and cotton. And I do understand 0.00001% may wear a khadi in the wedding, but what about the rest of the India? So I always think, you know, if I don't think the wedding scene is bad, and I think if they don't have a good or bad aesthetic, then either I keep my mouth shut or I do something about it. So I always said, you know, this Bollywood film I don't like. Then I was thinking, you know, if I don't like, do I have a better version to present? Or do I have a solution? Or do I, you know, what do I do about it? Or just skip around it? So I think this whole brocade langa, when we started in 2014, I don't think so, for 1.5, 2 years, people really warned that. And they thought it doesn't have any work. It's just woven, doesn't embroidery. But right now, I think, I should not say that, but I think brocade is pretty popular right now. And I can see in a lot of other designers' works too. That is one of the collection done in Varanasi. To me, I always question the visual imagery also. So I used to think, you know, if that's how the craft or art historian or people or in craft council, they used to talk about, you know, there is an 8 horse in that border, and that's how the tail is. And there is a then Rudraksh border after that, or that particular color of the salvage, and that's what makes the real sari, or that's what is real, the particular craft. I always question that, you know, who made the first elephant in a sari? Who made the first lotus in our sari? I'm sure someone must have thought of, someone must have broken the tradition of introducing that motif. Because we were, if you talk about tradition was always broken. We were, for 1,000 years, wore nothing actually. We were all naked. And we wore that tradition we first wore leaves maybe, and then we were textile, and then we were simplified textile, then we were brocade or e-girth or many other things. So I really wanted to introduce this monkey, and that was actually, it was a joke for actually the people, that the so-called purists of the textile in the business. I really wanted to ask them, why can't I make a monkey if it's a pretty indigenous from India and you also worship Hanuman, then why can't monkey be another elephant? When you see an elephant in India, you don't really question why the elephant is. You don't even notice it. So I really wanted to ask, can monkey become another cow or an elephant? This is a very recent collection on chicken curry. So in chicken curry also, there was never seen as any human motifs. And as it's woven in Lucknow. So this is a very recent collection, which is called Cloud People, if you see those angels. And this is just a line drawing, but that we made in the sari in chicken curry. Well, we started with the 4 looms when Uma met me, and now we are working around 1200 weavers. And I don't have any factory setup, so everything is happening exactly the way it is. And I have also, don't think so, made any changes in the loom. I really think, you know, we all go as an outsider there and tell them, oh, the loom is not really big, and you know, it's just a two paddle. I don't know how many people understand the techniques of either two paddle or a dobby or jacquard. If you don't have jacquard, I can't make big patterns. Oh, you don't have a dobby, so it's, you know, I just can't do much. But we all created whatever existence they have. So we actually work in Chanderi just with out of two paddles. And that's what I'm trying to say. We didn't really make change of any loom or the existing their skill set. It's just about the play of color, motif, design, better yarn. So I'll take back to that how, so this is one of our wedding campaign, and we were discussing about the makeup, and as you know that I don't know anything about the makeup, and if I talk about any person, you know, who consult or style consultant, they will only go look through the Western references for the fashion. I always worried, you know, where I don't really want to follow it, and what is my connection? Why Indian bride has to follow that lipstick color or that kind of hairstyle for her wedding? So I was always lack of references, and that right hand side of photo is my father actually, and there's a ritual where with a coin or something, I think it's a coin only, with the help of the coin you draw the guy's bhabhi, the sister-in-law, she draws something on her face like that, and that's how he leaves and goes for the wedding, before he goes out from their own house to the girl's house. So that's how you can see that. We recently also had a mela. That's our Lodhi store, by the way, I'm going to come back to again. And we've been having a lot of cultural activities, dance, performance around our area. We had a monkey business show. We also collaborated with the museums. We had once a chorus from a church. So we also wanted to write our own museum. We just worked on our 10 different objects for Raw Mango. I'm going to come back to that as well. This is one of the baithak organized on a Raw Mango 10th year. This is again, so I've seen this in old film and the villages, you know what baithak's like. So I wanted to question that, you know, why do I have to do again what fashion designer does in India? How do I even celebrate my 10th year differently? And then we had this baithak where people just sit down and it's all white, and we had two musicians, Chanupika and... This collection was a part of a monkey business, if you can see. So I really told them, girls, you know, I really want that the body language to be very monkeying around, you know. How will you become a monkey? How do you become really naughty? And that's how this hanging thing came in, and that's photo it is also, you know. So this is a very different language. I was thinking only monkey in my head, and that's how we derived this language for the fashion. This is a very recent collection, Cloud People, in 2017, actually not recent, 3 years ago. So Cloud People, to me, we wanted to work on an angel, as I said, but the Cloud People came, name from a parent. There's a tribe which worship the people from the Cloud People, and so to me, in my mind, it's something that, you know, you go to Northeast, And there's something that you don't know them. You actually just found the tribe. That kind of mysterious vibe I wanted when I see those girls. That's how the suit was derived. And this actually the makeup also, if you see on our head. So we were trying for 4 hours. We couldn't achieve, you know, what kind of makeup we have to do for the cloud people. And I just took some of the color on head and said, that's cloud to me. That's another one. That's a very recent one here. These are the 10 objects what I was just talking about. So we also wanted to explore our language through different 10 objects.